Phyllis's brother-in-law, Stan Harvey, is still in the hospital. I still don't know what's wrong with him, but he's in some pretty serious pain. They had him doped up yesterday, but we had a good visit. He and I go way back. When Paul and I were at Colonial Hills Baptist Church up in town, we had a men's breakfast, men's Bible study at 6:30 on Wednesday morning. And Stan used to just pour into me, and I mean, so we go way back. He's a great guy, knows the word, but so he's got some issues there. So let's pray. Father, thank you for a beautiful day. What a great sunset, Lord. We just see that you paint the sky in such ways that we can't even imagine. So we thank you for that, Lord. Lord, watch over Stan and Patty, and watch over the girls, and we just lift him up to you, Lord. Pray that they'll just figure out what's wrong with him and some of these tests, Lord. So many people that are got allergies, they got pneumonia, they got all kinds of stuff. One buddy of mine today had open heart surgery today, so we just pray for him, Lord. Thank you. Thank you so much for the opportunity just to talk to you and lift up our request to you. So thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So the bowls, we are going to talk about the bowls. The bowls are important, and so I've got a picture up here. I'll get to that in a minute. But as you can see, we're the area we're talking about, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Syria, Iran, Turkey, that's called the Fertile Crescent. So we'll talk a little bit about that here in just a few minutes. But I'm getting untangled. I'm liable to hang myself one night up here. So we're going to be in verses 8 through 16 tonight of chapter 16. And so in verses 8 and 9, we looked at the first and second and the third bowls last week. And so verses 8 and 9, we're going to start with the fourth bowl. And it says the fourth, he's talking about an angel, the fourth poured out his bowl on the sun. It was allowed to scorch people with fire, and people were scorched by the intense heat. So they blasphemed the name of God, or they cursed. Some translations say they cursed the name of God who has the power over these plagues, and they did not repent and they did not give him glory. And so the fourth trumpet, it's a judgment. It darkens the sun. We go back to Revelation 8:12 and see that the parallel verse there. But what happens here is the sun's intensity is increased dramatically. And so we see a contrast here from the first three angels who poured out their bowls on the earth. And this fourth angel pours his bowl out on the sun. And so we know that God created the sun on the fourth day of creation. Go back to Genesis and see that. And as a result, we get light, we get heat, warmth, energy. And so we see a little contrast there. So now in the tribulation, the sun becomes a deadly killer. And it's going to scorch people with fire. Again, these are supernatural events, and this is some heat that people have never seen before. Nobody on the earth has ever seen this type of heat before. It scorched the people with the sun's fierce heat, and the same people who had the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. Go back to verse 2 where it says, at the end of that, it says, the first went and poured out his bowl on the earth, and severely painful sores broke out on the people who had the mark of the beast and who worshipped his image. So this is goes all the way back to the Old Testament in the book of Isaiah, which I didn't mark. So let me get there. I thought I did. I might have marked it in one of my other Bibles I was studying with. Isaiah 24, verses 4 to 6, it says this. It says, the earth mourns and withers, the world wastes away and withers. The exalted people of the earth waste away. It's just telling us, look, the elite, these high, people that have exalted themselves, they're going to waste away. The earth is polluted by its inhabitants, for they have transgressed teachings, overstepped decrees, and broken the permanent covenant. It was like, to me, it's just saying, hey, there was a two-justice system back then, just like there is today. And verse 6 says, therefore, a curse has consumed the earth and its inhabitants, and they have become guilty. And so we just see that judgment being talked about back there in the Old Testament. Another real serious consequence of the intense heat of the sun would be the melting of the polar ice caps. And, we hear about this global warming, all that, and our daughters in Park City, Utah, they had 6 feet of snow up there yesterday, and it's 24 degrees, and so You know, and I don't know if you saw it on my Facebook page, the lady that Brenda Krim, who runs the mission, the Alaska Missions, she was on the Kenai River the other day at sunset where we did the salmon frenzy deal. And so you see all the ice that's come up on the riverbank there just piled high and high. It's 2 degrees when she was up there. So I don't know. But I just know the earth through history has cooled and it gets warmer. But here we see the melting of the polar ice cap. So the result is the rising water in the oceans, the streams, and there will be intense flooding. I mean, last week we had just under 7 inches at our house just up the road here. And when you come down 2493 from 69 going north, it looked like there was oceans on either side of the road. And so if you could just imagine what we're talking about here. There's going to be tremendous damage and loss of life. A lot of people are going to die in that melting of the polar ice cap and the subsequent rising of the ocean's water level. And so, again, just a lot of misery on the earth, on the planet, that's already suffered some real serious judgment. As believers, you would think that when they see these things, now remember, we're in the tribulation, so you would think that the judgment that the people that are alive, that are left alive on the earth, you would think that would drive them to repentance. But we don't see that. What's actually happening is so many of them are driven farther away from the Lord. And so in Romans 12:2-4, we know that God's judgment is designed to call sinners to repentance, like Pharaoh, or harden their hearts. There's a lot of heart hardening going on in the Old Testament. I was talking to, we were talking in our Bible study the other day about why people can't see the truth, can't understand the truth. Number one, they don't want to because they live for today. And how hard some people make the gospel, how hard some churches, whether it be pastors or preachers or priests. The guy that leads our Bible study, Ron Wells, you've heard me talk about him. He said one of Vince Lombardi's greatest stories was the Packers had lost maybe it was a playoff game, and they played really bad. And Vince Lombardi, everybody knows who that is, don't you? Vince Lombardi got a football, and he went into the locker room with the guys that they were standing there, and he says, "This is a football." Have you heard that? Yeah, this is a football, just so you know. And so this is the football. This is the word right here. This is the Bible. And so people make it so difficult. Paul and I went to the funeral today, and it's an Episcopalian funeral. And if you've never experienced something like that, it was an experience. But there's so much tradition, and we've talked about that in this Bible study in Galatians when I was talking to you about the Protestant Reformation. That's what caused the Protestant Reformation was against legalism. And why those guys, Martin Luther and some of those guys, stood up. But that's not going to drive people to repentance. Many times it's going to drive them away. And it says right here, instead of blaming their sin, the most shocking example of hardness of heart in history is they cursed the name of God. It says right there in verse 8 and 9, it says, so they blaspheme the name of God. So they understand who's causing this, who is allowing this to happen. And they cursed him, and they did not repent, and they did not give him glory. So I want to go back to Leviticus and read a piece of scripture to you that's a script reference under this verse 9 here. In chapter 24, and what happens is, it says the Lord spoke to Moses, and he said, command the Israelites. So he told the Israelites, he commanded them to do something, this certain thing. And there's a woman, an Israelite woman, who marries an Egyptian, and they have a son. So what that's a picture for us of the nation of Israel who rebels against God. So the son curses the name of God, and the Lord told Moses, said, bring the one who has cursed to the outside of the camp and said, have the whole community stone him. So it's a parallel to what we're seeing right here. The hardness of heart and the Israelites rebelled against God. So why? The question, why? Why did they do that? And so, again, they knew he was directly responsible. God was directly responsible for all the misery that they were experiencing. And so, for me, I just consider that to be really amazing, almost unbelievable. If they know it's God, he had control over those plagues. It says that in the verses here, there at the end of verse 9, or in verse 9 it says, so they blaspheme God, the name of God, who has the power over these plagues. They know he has the power, he was the one inflicting the pain on them, all this agony they were experiencing. And it's even more amazing to me that the beast worshipers love their sin so much that they just stayed the course. But that's really no different than what we see today, people loving the world. And just, I think I've told y'all about a guy, I don't know, back last summer, guy's probably 50, somewhere in there, been a post-smokes pot every day of his life. And he said, man, I ain't going to quit. I like it. I like it so much, I'm just going to keep doing it. Okay, that's the mentality that these people have here in the tribulation. They refuse to repent and they refuse to glorify God. So up to this point, only the Antichrist is described as blaspheming God. But here, the world adopts his character, his evil character. They take on all the evil that he is. And so we know that evil overwhelmed them to the point where no grace, the wrath of God, nothing is going to change their hearts. Nothing is going to cause their evil, wicked hearts to come to repentance and turn to God. They love what they do. They love their evil. And so in 11:13, we go back and look at that, you can see that the earthquake brought some to repentance, but not in this set of judgments here. So the arrogance, pride, is a lot of that. Their love for their sin, their love for Antichrist, because of that, they will continue to hate God. And they refuse to repent. They refuse to glorify him. And in John 3:19, I don't write that down either, or mark that. But the book of John chapter 3 is about, get over here. John 3:19 says this. This is the judgment. This is Jesus speaking. This is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light because their deeds were evil. See it today. See it today where people's hearts are hard. So God is just. That's what I was talking about Sunday, about we're justified by our faith. God is just. He is the righteous judge. You can go to Joshua 7 and look at that. So the point of this fourth bowl is the love of God does not bring people to repentance. And the judgment of God is not going to bring them to repentance. Fifth bowl, verse 10. The fifth bowl, or the fifth angel, poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and its kingdom was plunged into darkness. Man, just think about it. What kind of anger did that cause? What kind of catastrophe did that cause when God poured out that bowl on the throne of the beast? I'm sure there was, well, it says the people gnawed their tongues because of their pain. And they blasphemed the God of heaven. They gnawed their tongues. That just, I don't know about y'all, but that just sounds horrible to me. But God begins now to focus his attention on Antichrist, one of his biggest adversaries on earth. He loves spiritual darkness. That's the reason he was kicked out of heaven. And so God will give him physical darkness. Physical darkness. So the earth is going to be dark. It's going to cover the planet. And according to Malachi 4:1, it says, for look, the day is coming, burning like a furnace or oven, as some translations say. And verse 10 here says, it's not going to only be a physical darkness. It'll be a moral and spiritual darkness. And listen, I think we see that today a lot. And so it's going to be similar to the darkness that covered the lands of Egypt when Moses was trying to free the Hebrews. And you go to Exodus chapter 10 and read about that. But God's going to turn up, he's going to turn up the intensity even more. The suffering is going to become greater on the sinful world by turning out the lights. I don't know about y'all, but I do not like the dark. When Paul is gone, me and the dog sleep with a little lamp on it on the side, on her side of the bed. She said, "I can't believe you do that." I said, "I need to know what that dog's doing. If I feel him get up in the night, I want to know where he's going." And Paula likes it dark. And so we in the big room, whenever I want to turn the big light on, I have to go, "Big light," so it doesn't hurt her eyes. So, but can you imagine living in darkness where you can't see anything? I mean, that's pretty freaky. And so that's what we're talking about. God's going to turn out the lights. People will be able to see the stars, the moon, not even the sun. And the last time the darkness covered the earth, remember when that was? That was when Jesus hung on the cross. And so this is the last time it will happen to fulfill several Old Testament prophecies. As always, there are commentators and scholars that disagree over things, but over specifically how this bowl is going to be dumped. Something is going to be on the actual throne that the beast sits on, the throne. Others think it will be on the capital city of Babylon, and still others think it will be on the entire kingdom. So the entire kingdom is the world. He is the God of this world. So I don't know, but we have an idea of what that's going to look like. So John MacArthur thinks it's best to see the throne as a reference to the kingdom, since the bowl poured out on the throne darkens the entire kingdom, the entire world. To me, that makes sense. Again, this is just these guys from years of study, that this is their opinion. So the beast is going to be as helpless to the power of God, just like anybody else. Just like anybody else. He's going to be helpless to the power of God. So Joel describes the time of judgment as, over in Joel, there's some verses. A day of darkness, gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon grow dark and the stars lose their brightness. Zephaniah described the day of the Lord as a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and darkness. And Jesus, in all that discourse, and we've studied that, that's Matthew 24:25. It says, in those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. So the cumulative effect of all this goes back to those bowls we saw last week. It talks about the painful sores, talks about the polluted oceans, no drinking water. I mean, how bad is that? I mean, how bad is it not to have fresh water to drink? I can't imagine that. Intense heat, everything clothed in complete darkness, and all that's going to bring unbearable misery to those people on the earth at that time. So, incredible as it seems, the wicked, unbelieving people of the world will still refuse to repent. Now, that's just pure D.O., hard-headedness and hard-heartedness. When you know who's doing that and why he's doing it, to turn them to him, they still refuse to repent. And John 16:10 states that men gnaw their tongues because of their pain and their agony. How much agony do you have to experience? How much pain do you have to experience to gnaw your tongue? I just can't even imagine. It says they just kept on chewing on their tongues. They did that because of the excruciating pain, and they cursed, blank as they cursed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and they refused to repent of what they'd done. That's a little repetition, but it's important to understand that what they're doing and how they are responding, actually how they're reacting to the pain that's being inflicted on them by God. And so that's an ultimate act of defiance when you completely reject God. Sad. So the consequence is they're totally committed to the Antichrist satanic system. And again, guys, I can't stress to you enough how prevalent that is in our society today. And nobody wants to talk about it, but it is It's very prevalent. I talked to a couple this week whose young son went to jail, and I told him, I said, I don't know how the system works now, but I do know that guys in prison and in jails can talk to their loved ones on a regular basis. I don't know how that works, because when we were doing ministry in prisons, that they couldn't do that. But I told her, I told his mom, I said, encourage him to pay attention to what's going on. Don't let him be seduced by, I said, those guys are criminals, and he's not a criminal, but he messed up. But I said, those are criminals, and they will suck him into that darkness. Remind him. So, Christ, Antichrist, satanic system. So that's the last reference to the unwillingness to repent. The last reference to their unwillingness to repent. So these first five bowls are God's final call to repentance. Sinners ignored that call. They still ignore that call today. They are confirmed in their unbelief. And so these final two bowls, the sixth and seventh bowls, those are going to be the most severe of all the judgments. And they will be poured out on these hardened, unrepentant souls. So people blame God. They blame God for their sins. They don't accept the blame. Everybody's doing this, pointing fingers. Who, me? They don't accept blame for their choices. They don't accept blame for their actions. They choose to curse God. Again, just want to keep reminding you of that. And so they continue to follow the Antichrist and his false prophet. So that's the fourth and the fifth bowls. The sixth bowl, that starts in verse 12, and it says this. The sixth angel poured out the bowl on the great river Euphrates. Now, we've talked about that river. And its water was dried up to prepare the way for the kings of the east. The Euphrates River is in the process of drying up as we speak. It is currently in that state, and it continues to dry up. I'm not going to read all these verses yet, but it says, then I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming from the dragon's mouth, from the beast's mouth, and from the mouth of the false prophet. So these demon spirits, they're already working to draw the nations into a decisive battle of mankind. Do we see that happening in the Middle East today? Very likely. We see it possibly in Ukraine, possibly in Taiwan. These nations are being drawn into, I haven't read it yet, but I've got on my computer, I get email every day from Dennison Forum, Dr. James Dennison in Dallas. He writes, and the title is, Are We Prepared for World War III? So I haven't read it yet. But I mean, that's on people's minds. So how are they going to do that? So they're going to go into the hearts and minds of people. Where is the very first place that Satan begins to attack us? Right here. And that just goes right down to our heart. Right in our head. He attacks our minds. And so they're going to attack the hearts and minds of people. They're going to become pawns in the hands of evil, the evil one. He's going to drive people into the cataclysm of wickedness. You ever thought about how people could become a suicide bomber? How could people become pedophiles? How could people, there's a woman I happened to see on the, listening to the news, I was driving the other day, and she stabbed her boyfriend, I think 100-something times, and I think they'd been smoking pot, and I don't know what happened, but then she didn't get convicted. She's California. She got off on like 6 months probation or something like that. So look, people are just how do these people that have committed these mass murders in churches, how do you get to that point? How do you get to that point? So that's what is happening. We think it's bad now. just wait until the church is removed from the world. It's going to be even worse. So unlike the previous five bowls, this sixth bowl, like the fifth bowl, doesn't specifically assault humanity, but it prepares for what is to come. Now, I wrote that, but I also think, you know, I go back and I look at the fourth or the first bowl, which says, talks about painful sores. To me, that's an assault. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. But that's what I wrote. But it's preparing for what's to come. And so the problem this bowl, the sixth bowl, poses for those on earth is not the judgment itself, but it's the consequences. And the consequences is war. War. So we're leading up to something here, as you can imagine. And so it doesn't inflict a plague. It just serves as a preparation for the final eschatological battle, which is Armageddon. Armageddon. So when this sixth angel, when his turn comes, he pours out his bowl on the Euphrates River. And we talked about that back in chapter 9. And this is when 200 million demons were bound where the trumpet was. They were released. 200 million demons are released. I don't know what that looks like, but it can't be good. So we at that time, and probably, I don't know if it's true today, the Euphrates is the longest, most significant river in the Middle East. And so here's just a little history. It's called the Great River in the scripture. It's a source in the snowfields and ice cap high on the slopes of Mount Ararat. A lot of people don't think about snow over in that part of the world, but it happens. It flows about 1,800 miles before emptying into the Persian Gulf. In ancient times, the Garden of Eden was located near the Euphrates. It's also the eastern boundary of the land God gave to Israel. And along with the nearby Tigris, the Euphrates is still the lifeblood of the Fertile Crescent. So here's the Fertile Crescent, that area in green there. And so if we go down to the next part, it says, the Fertile Crescent is often referred to as the cradle of civilization. And so you've got Egypt, you've got Jordan, you've got Israel, you've got Syria, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, up into Turkey, and some portions up there of what used to be Russia, I guess Azerbaijan. Lebanon's in that. So that was what was called the Fertile Crescent. And so by the time the sixth bowl is poured out, the Euphrates is going to look a lot different. I didn't bring my pointer, but the Euphrates, if you look at Iraq, see Syria, just above Syria, you can see the Euphrates and the Tigris running sort of parallel from northwest to southeast down towards Baghdad. That's going to look a lot different when we get to this point in time. The heat from the sun is going to make a tremendous difference. The fourth bowl is going to melt the snow and the ice cap on Mount Ararat. And so the volume of water is going to increase. I don't know how that happens, but when that happens, we have massive flooding and massive death in its path. And whatever bridges cross the river, they're going to be destroyed. So the ability to move back and forth is going to be out of the question. So the reason for the sixth bowl is the angel dumps his bowl and the waters dry up to prepare the way for the kings that are going to come from the north. We talked about the north. They're going to come from Russia on down into Israel. And so those armies are going to need to cross the Euphrates to get to their ultimate destination, which is Armageddon in the land of Palestine. So what God does there by drying up, what the sixth bowl does by drying up the Euphrates is not an act of kindness to the kings from the east. It's an act of judgment. And it's a trap. It's a trap, sort of like when Pharaoh and his armies were chasing the Israelites and they get to the Red Sea and God parts the sea, and you know, it's not muddy, it's dry land where he parts it so that they can go across, and then the Pharaoh's armies entered the Red Sea, and you know what happens there. So this is a judgment. It's a trap that they're entering. And so the loss of water is going to lead them right to their death, just like the Red Sea, the parting of the Red Sea and the destruction of the Egyptian army. So it's interesting how all this ties together. But nobody knows for sure who the kings of the East are, but we've talked about it enough. There's enough being written about it today. China, North Korea, Russia, maybe India, maybe Japan. We don't know that. We talked about it in chapter 9 of Revelation about the 200 million man army. There's nobody on earth that we know of today that can produce a 200 million man army. But Russia and China and some of these other countries together can do that. Iran, they can do that. And one guy said that number increases by more than 10 million each year. So in less than a generation, it's estimated that the oil wells will be dry. They will invest heavily in the Middle East to build ships and vehicles, transport their armies. So back in the late 70s, my dad worked for American Motors. My dad went to Egypt, to Cairo, as a vice president for American Motors, and this consortium of countries was Iraq and Iran and Saudi Arabia and, I don't know, Lebanon, Jordan, I don't know all of them. And so the problem was those armies over there, they were going to build half-track vehicles. So that you've seen them in the movies, that their troops will be in the back. And so what they were building were top-heavy, and they were rolling in the desert and killing their troops. And so they asked American Motors to come over there because of the Jeep they built to build a prototype and to transport their armies. And so this has been going on for quite a long time. And so if these countries, these kings of the East join forces, that's exactly, that's kind of a picture of what we may see in the future. They're going to upgrade their weapons. What killed that deal, my dad is a very detailed guy, and he does not like lack of order or chaos. And so the plant was in Alexandria. And so the first group of these things that came from the plant down to Cairo, my dad is out on the dock at the railroad station with his interpreter, and he sees there's 100 vehicles. And he asked his interpreter, he said, "Is there somebody sitting in the driver's seat of every one of those vehicles?" "Yes." "Why?" "Well, they've got their foot on the brake so the truck won't roll off the train." My dad's head almost exploded. So he told him, he said, it's a little sidetrack, but it's funny. It's not funny, but it is. He said, "Chain them down. Chain them to the railroad cars." So the next group that came in, they let the air out of the tires, threw the chains over the hoods, aired the tires back up, and destroyed the hoods. Then he found out they were mounting 50 caliber machine guns on the back of those half tracks, and that killed the deal. So, guys, this stuff is already—it's been going on for a long time, but it's going to escalate tremendously. They're going to threaten the neighbors so they won't help the United States if China gets into a war with the USA, and the thought is that this war will probably start in the early part of the last half of the tribulation. It's going to cover a large portion of the earth, end up in the Middle East with the nations coming together to attack Israel. I am just stupefied how these idiot politicians, excuse me. So if any one of you in here think that the two-state solution, that there is such a thing, that is so false. That'll never happen. Why? Because all those neighboring, the Hamas and Hezbollah and all of, they want to eradicate Islam. They want to eradicate Israel from the face of the earth, from the sea, from the ocean to the sea, or whatever that thing is they say, from the Jordan, from the river to the sea, from the Jordan to the Med. And why? That's all I'll say about that. We're on the same page, I think, but I just, that's been, they've been talking about that for as long as I can remember. But whatever the human motives are of that army, whether it's political rebellion or rabid anti-Semitism, which we are seeing today in our country, in our colleges, the real reason behind their advance toward Palestine is evident. And again, it is to destroy and eradicate Israel and the Jewish people. So John gives us this vision here of these three unclean spirits, like frogs coming from the mouths of the dragon and the beast and the false prophet. So they are demonic spirits performing signs who travel to the kings of the whole world to assemble them for the battle on the great day of God the Almighty. And so we talked about that a minute ago, Armageddon. So from the source, and here's the source. The source says this. Jesus says, look, verse 15, look, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who is alert and remains clothed so that he may not go around naked and people see his shame. There he said, look, I am coming. I'm coming. He is the source. He's the source. But he gives the source of the influence to the influence to all these people is the Antichrist and the dragon and the false prophet. And so the unclean spirit resembles the frog. He's talking about unclean animals. They're not literally frog, but they're just, he's talking about the plague in Egypt. John just used that description. Kind of like a ghost of evil spirits and spirits of demons and that sort of thing. But he gives us a graphic description. It is somewhat revolting, and it's certainly disgusting to me because I hate frogs. I was watching one of those Indiana Jones movies last night about, you know, when he went into the museum, the church, and he went to the floor and he went down to the catacombs and there was rats in his... He said his dad never would have made it because he hated rats. I hate frogs. I don't want to. My wife, I'd get her to come pick them up and throw them out wherever they are. She's not. So we offset each other's goofy stuff. But he gives us the picture of the something that's real slimy and it's cold-blooded and it's just a vile... something vile about these demons, and they're here to seduce those kings of the east into making that long journey, and their doom will be at Armageddon. They'll be deceived just like people today are being deceived. Out of the mouth, it talks about some proclamation. They'll join together in making this proclamation to get those armies to join together to converge on Palestine, and. Satan's purpose is to annihilate the Jews. We talked about that. We know that. We know what his purpose is. And so that's when Jesus is going to come back to the earth, specifically to the Mount of Olives in Zechariah 14:2. So these demons, they'll perform supernatural signs. We'll see the false prophet perform great signs. He'll even make fire come down out of heaven to the earth in the presence of men. And so there's several other things here, but the very last one, said the unclean evil spirits of demons will work wonders to deceive the kings of the east. So the demons are going to have greater powers of deception, even greater powers. They won't have any difficulty in deceiving those kings to get them to come down the Euphrates. Their mission is not just to gather the Eastern powers, but all of the world's rulers and armies to join forces from the East for the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Their pride and arrogance, the demonically deceived nations of the world will converge on Palestine to do battle with himself at Armageddon. And we see in Revelation 17, we get there, that these 10 kings will be involved. So the war... Heard me say this, it's called a war. Knowing God's supernatural power, I don't see that it's going to last very long. And I wrote that here. The war will be over quickly. In fact, we'll see in Revelation 19 that it won't be a war. It'll be a slaughter. So, in the midst of all this stuff, the judgment, deception, war, comes an encouragement there in verse 15 where he says, blessed is the one who is alert and remains clothed. Be prepared. Stay with me. Stay committed. Follow me. No matter what you see, no matter how bad it gets, stay with me. He said, so that he may not go around naked and people see his shame. Stay hooked. So, complete horror. There's chaos. People are scared frantically. And these people had to know that the time is coming. The day of the Lord's coming. I can't imagine what that must be like. I'll give you some scriptures here in Malachi. You can go read those. But God told them not to be afraid because they belong to him. Those in the tribulation who belong to God, who have stayed the course, he will watch over them because they belong to him. Words of encouragement. We see that here in the sixth, and we'll see it in the seventh seals. Or we saw it in the seals in chapter 10. But these bold judgments, they're going to come quick. And the interval between the sixth and seventh is going to be brief. And we'll get to the seventh next week. But just a few final comments. He says, look, I come like a thief. But he said, not like a thief. He said, I'm not coming to steal, but I'm coming to take what's rightfully mine. He's coming to take his people, those who have stayed the course with him, those who have stayed committed to him. And in Revelation 3:3, we see he warned the church at Sardis to wake up. Many people need to wake up today. He said in the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24, be alert. 1 Thessalonians 5:2, Paul reminded the Thessalonians the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. And Peter reaffirmed that in 2 Peter 3, verse 10. So his return is going to be quick. It's going to be sudden. Nobody knows the day, the time, of the hour. We know that. And it's going to bring fear. It's going to bring discouragement to his enemies, but hope and comfort. Hope and comfort to his people. And then he pronounced the third of seven beatitudes, or blessings and benedictions. He said, blessed is he who stays awake and keeps his clothes with him so that he may not go naked and be shamelessly exposed. Now that's the NIV. But what he's describing is those who will be prepared, those who will be prepared for his arrival. He gives us some imagery of soldiers that are alert and on duty. They're standing ready for combat. They're standing on the wall, I guess, ready for combat. Those who are not prepared will go naked and be shamelessly exposed. And so it shows the shame of a soldier not being prepared. Not being prepared, being derelict in his duty. And those that Jesus finds prepared when he returns will be blessed. So after that little encouragement there in verse 15, in verse 16 he says, so they assembled the kings at the place called, in Hebrew, Armageddon. He returns to the events here of the sixth bowl. And so these demon spirits, they've gathered at the place of Armageddon. In Hebrew, it's called Har-mageddon, and it means Mount Megiddo. Now, I'd ask Erica to pull this up. Mount Megiddo, I forgot to look and see how high it is, but there have been many battles fought there, and that's where Armageddon's going to be fought. John, do you know how high it is? I don't either. I was going to look that up, and I forgot. But there's no specific, and so the Valley of Jezreel, I think, is up to the north of the picture up there. But nobody knows any specific mountain by that name. Har can mean hill country. Maybe it's a reference to the hill country around the plain of Megiddo, approximately 60 miles north of Jerusalem. More than 200 battles have been fought at Megiddo. Some other information there. But there have been other battles in the vicinity of Jerusalem. But this battle, will be almost be over almost as quickly as it begins when Christ returns to rescue his people and defeat his enemies. So the resulting slaughter of the world's armies will be almost unimaginable. Blood will be splattered several feet high and running in streams for about 200 miles. We looked at that in chapter 14. They said as high as horses' bridles. So for 200 miles. Horrible. And so, sixth bowl sets the stage, but before that brief battle, the seventh and final bowl is going to be dumped. And so we'll pick that up next week. Pain. Isn't that what